Bonsoir Nicole, comment ça va? Well, I guess this is it, ladies and gentlemen. So thank you all for coming. Merci beaucoup d'être ici avec nous. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our very special presentation. Bonsoir tout le monde et bienvenue à notre présentation bien spéciale. My name is Dr. Paul Buck, je m'appelle Paul Buck, Associate Professor of History and Education here at the University of Maine at Fort Kent. Tonight, however, I'm wearing another hat as our Fulbright Campus Liaison, and I'll speak more specifically about the Fulbright program and about our speaker, Dr. Brendan Quinn, from the Burnett Institute in Melbourne, Victoria, Australia, in just a few moments. Here at UMFK, we're honored to have been granted the privilege of hosting this lecture through the auspices of the Fulbright Outreach Fund. Before I go any further, I would very much like to say many, many thanks, merci beaucoup, to Ms. Sarah Causer, Outreach Coordinator, and everyone at the Fulbright Program in Washington, D.C. Many, many thanks also go to Professor Sean Graham for helping to organize the many logistics and details of Dr. Quinn's stay with us, and of the three appearances he will be making with us this week. Thanks as well to Sean for his many invaluable insights vis-a-vis the theme of tonight's presentation. Many, many thanks also go out to our president, John Short. Unfortunately, he's attending a meeting, so he isn't able to be with us tonight, for suggesting and for wholeheartedly supporting this week that we're sharing with Dr. Quinn. Finally, I'd like to thank our nursing, allied health, criminal justice, human services, and psychology faculty for encouraging their students to attend tonight. Thanks as well to Dr. Quinn for agreeing to be with us this evening. And finally, thanks as well to everyone for being here, all of you. Merci beaucoup à tous et à toutes d'avoir choisi d'être ici avec nous ce soir. Now a brief word about Fulbright. The Fulbright family of programs dates back to 1946 and allows for cultural and academic exchanges through the U.S. Department of State to over 160 countries. The program is named after Arkansas Senator J. William Fulbright. There are different types of Fulbright experiences available. Our guest and speaker, Dr. Brendan Quinn, comes to us through the Fulbright Scholar Program, which is open to university-level researchers and professors. Dr. John Short, our president, is an alumnus of the Fulbright Hayes Administrator Exchange Program and has visited several countries, Senegal, Sierra Leone, Tunisia, and Russia, just to name a few through these programs. In my own case, I'm an alumnus of two Fulbright programs, two different ones. The Fulbright Teacher Exchange Program, through which, as a U.S. secondary level French teacher, I taught English in 1997 at Lycée Ganandou Diouf in Dakar, Senegal. As a grad student in history at the flagship campus of the University of Maine in Orono, I had a Canada-U.S. Fulbright to Quebec City. In short, the Fulbright program has broadened my cultural and linguistic understanding of the world immeasurably. And having talked with our president, Dr. Short, I know that the program has had a tremendous positive impact on him as well. This brings us to our speaker tonight, Dr. Brendan Quinn. He's an epidemiologist spending this academic year in Los Angeles at UCLA, working on research vis-a-vis methamphetamine treatment approaches and HIV transmission dynamics. Back in Australia, he's a researcher at the Burnett Institute in Melbourne, the largest city and capital of the state of Victoria. He earned his PhD in Melbourne at Monash University, did I pronounce that correctly? All right, in 2013. He's truly a delight to have with us here at UMFK. In the very short time that he's been in Northern Maine, we've quickly learned that he has an encyclopedic knowledge of his subject matter and is a delightful and very down-to-earth human being. Dr. Quinn's topic of substance abuse, harm reduction, treatment, and recovery truly strikes a chord in our society. Nearly all of us in this room either are traveling some portion of that road ourselves or, just as significantly, deeply love or care about a person or people who have faced or is facing these challenges of substance abuse and the even bigger challenge of the recovery process. One day at a time, or as we say in French, une journée à la fois. Indubitably, this subject is very, very personal to some of us. Just looking out at the folks here this evening, some of whom may have come from far away. Knowing that Dr. Quinn's talk is being sent via video conference to the University of Maine at Presque Isle, and knowing that this video will be viewed a number of times on YouTube, is an indicator of the deep impact of this topic on all of us. Thanks to all of you again for being here, and thanks to all of you who are watching from a distance, either live in Presque Isle or on YouTube. Now, without further ado, I would like to present our Fulbright Outreach Fund speaker tonight, Dr. Brendan Quinn.
Hi, everyone. Excuse me. Aaron, do I have to press, is he here? I think I have to press this button.
Maybe.
So that the other people can hear. Encyclopedic knowledge, that makes me very nervous. But thank you very much for coming out tonight. I am really excited to be here. I've never been to Maine before. I have spent the last 8 or 9 months in Los Angeles, so it's really nice to actually get out of the city and get to a different climate and meet different people, because as lame as it sounds, endless sunshine and blue skies and palm trees can actually get quite mundane after a while. I have lived in places with snow before, and I do really like mixing it up a bit. So thank you very much for being here. I realize that it is a Wednesday evening and you could be out doing more fun things instead of listening to me talk, so I do appreciate you being here. I should apologize if you can't understand some things that my accent might twist around for you. Feel free to ask any questions if you need any clarification or if you need any further information. It happens all the time, so I won't be offended. Just give me a second while I get my notes ready.
So my name is Brendan, and today I will be talking about problematic drug use and not so problematic drug use and addiction dependence here in the United States, including impacts on individuals, families and communities, and possibly even more wide-reaching impacts as well.
I've got this thing. This is just a brief summary of the areas that we'll be covering today. Firstly, I don't think I'm a narcissist, but I do have a fair few slides in there about myself. I just think it's important for you to understand why I do what I do, what I've done, my experiences, which kind of explain why I'm up here talking to you today. Then some of the main take-home messages that I hope you take with you tonight, followed by some of the broader drug trends in the United States and some more specifically here in Maine. And then we'll close out with some methods that have been implemented here in Maine and across the United States and elsewhere in the world
with regard to trying to prevent and reduce drug-related harms. Can everyone hear me okay?
Yes.
All good? Let me know if you can't hear me.
So, yeah, I am from Australia. Has anyone been to Australia? One person. I mean, it doesn't really surprise me. Maine's quite far. I think it might take over 30 hours to actually get to the East Coast, which is on the other side of the Pacific Ocean. This doesn't really give you a good idea of where it is in the world, but it tells you what it looks like. It's in the Southern Hemisphere. Again, it's on the other side of the Pacific Ocean to North America. And as Paul mentioned, I come from Melbourne, which is the second largest city in Australia, just to give you a little geography lesson about where I'm from. I actually grew up about 3 hours north of there in a tiny town called Yarrawonga that has, well, technically I grew up in a town that had 1,500 people, but the wider area had about 6,000 people. And my parents still live there. It's a lovely little place in the world, but again, I probably wouldn't recommend traveling 30 to 40 hours to get there from Maine. But I just wanted to let you know that I am from a small town, and I am very aware of how drug and alcohol issues can affect small communities in terms of problematic drug use trends, but also access to drug and alcohol treatment. So I am a drug and alcohol researcher, and I am an epidemiologist. I think it's the study of epidemics. A lot of people think it's the study of skin when I first meet them. Generally, I apply the theories of studying epidemics to monitoring drug and alcohol use trends and related harms in Australia, in America, and in other places in the world. The main focus of my research over the last, nearly the last decade, has been methamphetamine, and that falls under the broader umbrella of public health. Some of my other professional interests that I dabble in, include justice health, so investigating the health of prisoners and ex-prisoners and how that impacts the wider community. International health has been quite a passion of mine for the last few years since I finished my PhD, particularly in developing or third world countries. And I'll give you a couple of examples of projects that I've worked on in recent years in just a minute. Bloodborne viruses has been a big one for me, mainly hepatitis C and HIV. I'm moving a bit away from hepatitis C because in Australia, in light of recent discoveries of pharmaceuticals that are essentially a cure for hepatitis C in the last few years, the Australian government has invested billions of dollars to actually try and eradicate it from the country in the next 10 or so years, which means it's not really worth studying anymore. Injecting drug use trends is a big one, and that relates very much to hepatitis C and HIV, primarily because injecting drug use is a main mode of transmission for both those bloodborne viruses. At UCLA, I have been focusing much of my research on health issues for LGBTIQ communities, mainly men who have sex with men. I've got a cohort of about 400 to 450 men who have sex with men, and this is a group that are disproportionately affected by high HIV transmission rates. And I'm trying to look at the relationship between HIV transmission dynamics and substance use among mainly men of color who have sex with men, so African Americans and Latino Hispanic men who have sex with men. And bearing all this in mind, I'm really passionate about generating evidence-based practice and policy to try and address some of the issues that impact some of these communities. People and communities that I think are more disadvantaged and marginalized and disenfranchised than others. I just want to improve the lives of these people, essentially. But it can be very difficult in my line of work because, as you can see, a lot of them, well, some of these issues could be considered somewhat controversial. So convincing policymakers and people with money to change policy and practice around these issues that often aren't considered to be politically palatable can be quite difficult. In Australia at the moment, for example, my colleagues are trying to promote the use of drug testing at music festivals. We just had our big music festival season. It's coming out of summer. We had quite a number of non-fatal overdoses and a few fatal overdoses associated with ecstasy, GHB, that type of thing. And so we're really trying to push for drug testing at those events. We're also trying to implement a safe injecting room in a suburb of Melbourne that has really high rates of heroin fatal overdoses. But again, those issues aren't particularly popular amongst policymakers because they don't think the community will support them, so they don't think they'll get votes. And that's incredibly frustrating for us. Some examples of projects that I've worked on in the last few years, and not too much after that about myself. I conducted the longest study of methamphetamine use in Australia. I started doing that during my PhD. I recruited about 250 regular methamphetamine users in Melbourne. I initially followed them over 2 years, and then I was really lucky to have an honours student come along in 2015 who was really keen to try and follow up as many of that group as possible. She got about 50%, which I thought was actually a really good rate 5 years down the track. Broadly, we'll be looking at methamphetamine, the epidemiology of methamphetamine use in Melbourne, characteristics of people who were using it, how they were using it, shifts in and out of dependence and abstinence and recreational use over that time period, and also barriers to treatment utilisation for that group. And I'll talk a bit about my findings later, and I apologise if you're not interested in methamphetamine, but a lot of my examples will be about that because I guess it's my specialty. In 2015 and 2016, I investigated alcohol and other drug use and gender-based violence among young people in the Solomon Islands, so 15 to 24-year-olds. That was an incredible project, and it was one of the first of its kind in that country. And the findings informed a subsequent intervention that's being implemented by Save the Children. I'm not sure if you've heard of that non-profit organisation. But basically, we're trying to reduce rates of particularly problematic alcohol use and also violence against women in that country. I'm looking for an appropriate methamphetamine withdrawal, an appropriate pharmaceutical option for treating methamphetamine withdrawal and dependence among methamphetamine users. I'm involved in two projects. One of them's here in the United States at UCLA, and the other one's back in Australia. We're getting some really positive findings coming out of the UCLA one, so fingers crossed we get something good there. The Australia one's
not far enough along to talk about, unfortunately. Sorry, I'll finish up these in just a sec, but I investigated transnational organized crimes for the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime over 2015 to 2016. That sounds a lot sexier than it actually was. Most of my time was spent on my laptop, at my desk, in my house in Melbourne, Googling stuff. But it was really interesting. I got to learn about drug trafficking, manufacture, and weapon smuggling, and human trafficking, and environmental crimes. And that that project was mainly focused on the Pacific. So Pacific Island countries and territories between Australia and America. And lastly, I investigated HIV testing and treatment practices and associated risk behaviours among four groups of at-risk youth in a city called Bandung in Indonesia. Those groups were female sex workers, men who have sex with men, people who inject drugs, and transgender youth. That was a project for UNICEF. I conducted the initial baseline study that will be used to evaluate the project over time. So hopefully we can increase HIV testing and treatment uptake among those groups in that area. So the main messages that I take home, that I hope you take home with you this evening, I'm certainly not preaching that drugs are always bad, to steal or modify a quote from a South Park character, but I'm definitely not advocating substance use. I just want to clarify that I'm really not demonizing or trying to stigmatize anyone who has used alcohol or drugs or who does use alcohol or drugs, because I think that can be incredibly harmful. We will be talking about some key drug trends occurring across the United States and here in Maine, and I want you to think about how they might affect you, your peers, your friends, your family members, your community or your community, and possibly the entire country. And we will be talking about some methods that can be implemented to try and address harmful drug use and different types of drug use. And I really want to encourage some critical and constructive thinking around drug trends and how we can appropriately address problematic drug use via evidence-based policy and practice. And this is particularly in consideration of media and political coverage that can be really stigmatizing and misleading and even inaccurate. So I just want you to please consider what I have to say today with an open mind. So why do I do this? I've got a story, and this sort of underscores my thinking around drug and alcohol trends and why I do what I do. And I hope that, well, basically, I want you to think about this during the presentation today. So, a decade or so ago, I was having dinner with my extended family for my uncle's 50th. My grandmother, his mother, was present, of course. At that point, I had worked in drug and alcohol epidemiology for only maybe a year or two, but I'd spent years volunteering at a non-profit organization for young people who were affected by mental health issues and drugs or alcohol, something we call dual diagnosis. I can't remember how it came up, but my grandmother started criticizing people who use drugs. Her key points were that drug users are a drain on society. They don't have a positive impact. They're all bad people with no hopes of redemption and should be incarcerated. Furthermore, taking drugs only leads to bad things. I pointed to the glass of wine in her hand. But you're drinking a drug right now and nothing bad is happening, except for this argument, of course. This isn't a drug, she declared. This is alcohol and it's legal. This isn't going to make me throw myself through that window over there. Just pretend I'm an old English woman with a different voice, essentially. As someone who, by this point in my life, had experimented fairly thoroughly with alcohol and other drugs and who had a fair understanding of the effects of many types of substance use from both personal and professional perspectives, I realized that, number one, she lacked compassion for people who use drugs. She put them all in the one basket and didn't care about their well-being or their futures. She just cared about how their lives impacted hers. Number two, she demonstrated a remarkable lack of understanding about drug use, including the reasons people use various substances and the types of harms commonly experienced as a result of drug use. For example, I'm sure that more than one person in this world has thrown themselves through a window as a result of alcohol intoxication. I haven't done that, by the way. Number three, the legality of substances was a big issue for her, and I'm constantly surprised how much of an influencing factor it is in how people decide whether a drug is inherently good or bad. We have to remember that alcohol was once illegal, and in this state, marijuana was once illegal. It's been legalized or decriminalized? I can't remember. Legalized, yeah. So that can change how people think about particular drugs.
Very frustratingly for me, she lacked a willingness to learn about different perspectives and different experiences. She was perfectly comfortable living in her privileged and ignorant bubble where she could criticize and judge others from afar. And I learned over the following years that it wasn't just drugs that she had an issue with, it was race, ethnicity, socioeconomic status, that type of thing, religion.
I'm reminded of this conversation regularly through talking with other people and when I read the newspaper or articles online, and this motivates me to keep doing what I'm doing. During today's presentation, I want you to remember that for me, people who use alcohol and other drugs are still people. I've met and interviewed thousands over the last decade, people who use heroin, methamphetamine, alcohol, cannabis, poppers, mouthwash, gasoline, spray paint, nicotine and cocaine, plus numerous other substances. People who use drugs are incredibly diverse. Some are bad, just like you have bad people in any population or group of people, but many are very, very good, and they deserve a second or a third or a fourth or a fifth chance to try and get better and make a life for themselves. And some will end up contributing more to society than the rest of us. You also never know what someone's backstory is. One person might be born into a cycle of drug use, and another might be college educated and have suffered a horrible accident and now uses illegal morphine because they can't dull their pain through legitimate means. Essentially, it's important to listen to the facts. Like other fields, there are people working in the area of drugs and alcohol, researchers, treatment providers, healthcare practitioners, who have spent decades learning about what works and what doesn't. Whether it's drugs and alcohol or medicine or the environment, you need to listen to the intelligent people, the experts, who care and who know how to change the world in a positive way. I'm not calling myself an expert by any means, and I'm not saying I have encyclopedic knowledge. So, just to continue on that, licit and illicit drug use, particularly recreational or sporadic or infrequent and not particularly harmful consumption patterns, can result in many self-perceived benefits of use. And to highlight this, I've included some quotes from my methamphetamine using cohort, verbatim, about why they used methamphetamine or what they thought they got from it that was positive. So as you can see, you can classify these motivations, these different benefits into different categories. You know, you've got the functional ones, you've got self-medication, you've got using the drug for enjoyment. And for me, it's really important to understand why people use drugs and what they think they get out of it if you are, well, to make you able to help them if they need the help. Importantly, drug use can also lead to numerous adverse personal and interpersonal consequences. And this is essentially why I do my job, to try and prevent and reduce these types of harms. They include short and long-term mental and physical health problems, relationship breakdown with peers, with friends, family members, partners, that type of thing. Financial issues, not having enough money for food or for rent. Criminogenic harms, by which I mean engaging in criminal behaviours, for example, as a result of intoxication or to fund a certain quality of life. Homelessness is a huge one that's visible here in the United States. I'm currently living in Los Angeles. I've lived in San Francisco and a couple of weekends ago I was in New York City. And homelessness is everywhere. It has really strong ties to substance use, and particularly problematic substance use. And of course, death. And just to accompany that previous slide with some quotes from my crew. Here's some ones that talk about the types of harms that people experience from methamphetamine use. They cover some of those domains that we've talked about: financial, mental, physical, social, educational, and dependence. And just to be clear, the come down, in case you don't know, is the undesirable period in the few days following, usually psychostimulant use, where you might experience one, a few, or all of these unfortunate symptoms. And again, to reiterate, mortality is a significant drug-related harm. And this is evident here in this slide. I hope it's relatively clear for you. Shows that this is an increasing issue across the entire country. So to add some additional perspective or context to this, the dramatic increase in drug overdoses across the country over the last two decades means that drugs now kill more people than both cars and guns.
And I should clarify that the numbers of shootings listed here in this figure are both intentional and unintentional gun-related deaths.
So what types of drugs are commonly involved in fatal overdoses here in the United States?
There's some pretty pictures to keep you awake.
These data are from a report by the CDC, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, that investigated the top 10 drugs most frequently involved in fatal overdoses here in the United States from 2010 to 2014. I should note that substances excluded from consideration included alcohols, nicotine, food and food additives, gases including helium, carbon monoxide, for example, airborne contaminants such as soot, industrial chemicals, and substances with no known industrial, pharmaceutical, or abuse application. Does anyone recognize any sort of trends or common types of substances there?
You don't have to call out, I'll give you the answer. One common class of substances there is opioids, and this includes pain relievers that are available legally by prescription, including oxycontin, oxycodone, Vicodin, codeine, morphine, and fentanyl, and also illegal drugs, with the main one usually being heroin. And importantly, regular use, even if it is prescribed by a doctor or a healthcare professional, can lead to opioid dependence. And when misused, opioid pain relievers can lead to fatal overdose, as we're seeing in these numbers.
So the substances listed there in red are the opioids. And indeed,
about two-thirds of overdose cases involved licit or illicit opioids.
Simply put, Americans consume a disproportionately high number of opioids compared to every other country in the world, using 80% of the entire world's prescription opioid supply. And sorry, I feel a little bit bad saying this as an Australian. I'm definitely not trying to get on my high horse here.
Oops, sorry. In some states, doctors have filled out more painkiller prescriptions than there are people. The great thing is that Maine is not one of the bad ones, so congratulations.
So to summarize the CDC's findings regarding the drugs most frequently involved in overdoses, fatal overdoses over the last 5 years,
from 2010 to 2014, the top 10 drugs remained the same, but their ranking changed.
The number of drug overdose deaths per year increased about a quarter, from around 38,500 to just over 47,000. The age-adjusted rate of drug overdose deaths involving heroin more than tripled. The rate involving methamphetamine more than doubled. And the rate of overdose deaths involving fentanyl more than doubled in a single year. Unsurprisingly, given that I would argue most people who engage in substance use can be classified as polysubstance users, which basically means that they consume more than one drug at a time, although that definition can be a little bit fluid depending on who you're talking to and where you are in the world. We have around half of fatal drug overdoses involving more than one drug. And again, this is a highly significant public health issue. And it is important to note that these deaths don't just happen to your stereotypical street drug user. A couple of high-profile examples of recent deaths involving opioids include Philip Seymour Hoffman and Prince.
And what does the age-adjusted rates, is it a certain age category that's
coming up? I actually had to check that for you. Sorry, I had checked that previously and I wrote it in my notes, but I think I left it back at my room. Let me get back to you on that one, sorry.
No, I'm sorry.
No, you're more than welcome to, please. Feel free to do it.
I did check that, but I'm gonna have to be reminded. I'll get back to you on that one. One thing I wanted to briefly mention is that we're seeing changes in the race of people who start injecting in the United States, with a greater proportion of Caucasian people starting to inject drugs and a reduced proportion of African American people starting to inject drugs in 2015 compared to 2005. And the point I'm trying to make here is that it's important for any measures that address problematic drug use to reflect the dynamic characteristics of drug using populations. That's regardless of whether it's race, ethnicity, socioeconomic status, location, route of administration, etc.
So to talk about some drug trends across the United States, I'm going to be referring to findings from the National Survey on Drug Use and Health. This is a project that's conducted every year, a survey of the civilian non-institutionalized population who are aged 12 years and over. It excludes people who are classified as homeless and residents of various institutional group quarters, including jails, prisons, nursing homes, etc. And this is a really important limitation because some of these groups of people, I'm thinking mainly about homeless people and prisoners, are more likely to engage in substance use than the general community. So the figures I present today are possibly an underrepresentation of the true extent of drug use across the country. It is a face-to-face household survey. In 2015, they recruited just over 68,000 people, and the participants are categorized according to age. So adolescents are defined as people who are aged 12 to 17. Young adults are those aged 18 to 25 years, and adults are aged 26 years and over, and adults comprise 50% of the sample. And information is obtained regarding 10 different categories of illicit drugs: marijuana, cannabis, cocaine, heroin, hallucinogens like LSD and magic mushrooms, inhalants, methamphetamine, and misuse of prescription drugs. Are you guys okay to hear me? It seems to change a little bit, yeah? Regarding alcohol use, so around 138 million Americans aged 12 years and above were classified as current alcohol users in 2015. And this means that they'd consumed at least one alcoholic beverage on at least one occasion in the previous month. And this comprises about 43% of the country's total population. Of the current alcohol users, about half were classified as binge alcohol users. And we do have a couple of different definitions for men and for women, or a different definition for men and women. For men, binge alcohol use is defined as drinking five or more drinks on the same occasion on at least one day in the last 30 days. And for women, it's defined as drinking four or more drinks on the same occasion on at least one day in the last 30 days. Next, we have heavy alcohol use, with about 13% of current alcohol users being defined as heavy alcohol users. And this is really important to classify people who are engaging in the more problematic types of alcohol use, including binge use and heavy alcohol use, because these people are the ones who are going to experience more likely to experience short and long-term consequences of alcohol use. I should note that heavy alcohol use is defined as binge drinking on five or more days in the last 30 days. And notably, both binge and heavy alcohol use patterns were more common among 18 to 25 year olds.
And I think I just saw in the bathroom before, you guys, in the men's bathroom at least, you guys have those red cups with the statistics on them. I think it says about 20% of college age students engage in binge use, if I remember correctly.
Next, we have illicit drug use. So in 2015, around 27 million people were estimated to have used any illicit drug in the last month. Again, it was using at least one drug on one occasion. So 10% of the American population within that age range, 12 and above. As you can see, the most common drug used by Americans, common illicit drug, was marijuana, with around 22 million people using it in the last month.
And an estimated 6.4 million people reported misusing any pharmaceuticals in the past month, with the most common pharmaceutical misused being prescription pain relievers, and that comprises the opioids that we were talking about before.
And obviously you can see much smaller numbers of people engaging in other types of illicit drug use like cocaine, hallucinogens, methamphetamine, and inhalants.
To look at those numbers another way,
and similar to the alcohol findings, in 2015, the most common age group engaging in illicit drug use were 18 to 25 year olds, with about 22% of that age group.
So I'm assuming a lot of you fall into that category, yeah? I definitely don't. Next, talking about substance use disorders. So the National Survey on Drug Use and Health includes questions that classify people as having a substance use disorder in the last 12 months. They represent clinically significant impairment caused by the recurrent use of alcohol and other drugs, including some of the harms we've already talked about, physical and mental health problems, disability, failure to meet major responsibilities, etc. And this means that substance use disorders impact substantially on families and communities and on our health, social support and criminal justice systems. And to provide a couple of examples of that, at how costly, financially at least, they can be, I've got an Australian example here for you and one from the United States. The first, in 2007, methamphetamine-related societal costs, so for example, engaging in criminal activities and road accidents, were estimated to cost the Australian health and criminal justice systems approximately $3.7 billion that year, which is huge. It's very likely that this cost has since increased. For example, we're seeing, this is a figure that my colleagues produced back in Australia. It's a graph showing the purity changes in methamphetamine and heroin in Australia over 2009 to 2013. The main line that I want you to look at is the top one, the darker one. That's the purity of crystal methamphetamine changing over that period of time. And so it went from about 5 to 15-20% up to about 65-75% over that time period. And using drugs that are more pure, that are more potent, increases the likelihood of experiencing drug-related harms. Also, our version of the National Survey on Drug Use and Health shows that people who are using methamphetamine in Australia tend to be using it more frequently now than they were 10 years ago. In Portland, Oregon, I was really excited when I found this because I thought it was going to be Portland, Maine, but I was disappointed. A prospective study conducted in the emergency department of the Oregon Health and Science University Hospital estimated that charges for meth-related visits averaged around $130,000 per week and nearly $7 million annually. Just for interest's sake, the top four medical conditions associated with meth-related visits were mental health issues, followed closely by trauma and skin infections and dental diagnoses. So these are the diagnostic criteria for substance use disorders. I'll let you have a quick look to see what they are, and then I'll tell you how to diagnose one. So you can apply these criteria to any drug, and this is according to the DSM form. You just replace whatever drug you're interested in, you replace that with the red word substance. So it could be alcohol or heroin or methamphetamine, for example. And a substance use disorder is defined as a repeated occurrence within a 12-month period of two or more of these 11 problems. A cluster of six or more indicate a severe condition. So I hope I didn't make any of you nervous right now. With regard to the prevalence of substance use disorders in the American population, around 21 million people aged 12 years and above were estimated to have one of these in 2015. As you can see, the most common substance use disorder was alcohol, with nearly 16 million people. So more than double the number of people with any illicit drug use disorder had an alcohol use disorder. To look at these numbers another way, nearly three quarters of people aged 12 years and over who had a substance use disorder in the last year had an alcohol use disorder, while about one in three had an illicit drug use disorder. An estimated 2.7 million people aged 12 and over had both an alcohol use disorder and an illicit drug use disorder, which indicates that these people are really at risk of experiencing numerous drug-related harms. The findings I'm presenting today are not all doom and gloom. I like this graph because it shows that there's been somewhat of a decrease in the prevalence of alcohol use disorders in the American population over the last decade or so. And this seems to be driven primarily by a decrease in alcohol use disorders among people aged 18 to 25.
We're seeing similar trends in Australia among both high school students and tertiary students. And look, alcohol use isn't really my level of expertise, so I can't tell you exactly what's going on here. And I don't know if there's actually any definitive research out there that can give us
a concrete answer to this. But I've got a few colleagues and friends who work in alcohol use research, and they've provided me with a few theories, which I find quite interesting. One is the rise of the use of social media, which firstly might take time away from drinking and using other substances. I have Facebook. I don't use it that much, but I use it every now and again, and I can't for the life of me understand how people use Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and Snapchat and still have time to feed themselves. I'm showing my age. The other is that having a significant online presence might dissuade harmful people from engaging in harmful drinking patterns due to a desire simply to not look foolish online. You don't want to get drunk and have your friends take pictures of you and then you appear online looking smashed and throwing up and that type of thing. And also, many people are health conscious these days, and alcohol can make you look pretty unhealthy. For example, drinking beer can give you a beer belly, and not everyone wants that. I live in Los Angeles, where everyone wants to have 0% body fat, so I'm very aware of this. Regardless, significant numbers of people across all age groups are still getting classified as having a substance use disorder, an alcohol use disorder, and or an illicit drug use disorder, which means that there's still a lot of work to be done in this area. And I'll probably say that a few more times today. So this is an important slide because it shows that most people who are diagnosed as having a substance use disorder don't actually get drug treatment or professional support that we know of. This is a crucial point, again, because people who are classified as having a substance use disorder are the ones who are more likely to experience the extent of drug-related harms. And this figure indicates that there is a lot of unmet need out there among people who have substance use disorders. So why don't people with substance use disorders get treatment? One of the short answers is barriers to treatment utilization, and I'll divide this up briefly into three categories: personal, social, and structural. I will not talk about them in that order because for some reason I screwed up my slides. So just some examples of structural barriers to treatment utilization include a lack of available services. I've told you that I'm from a rural town myself in Australia. You guys are in Fort Kent. We're very aware that we don't have the types of services that you can get in larger cities, and this can be really problematic for people who are trying to access drug treatment. Also, limited service accessibility. A big one is cost. A good friend of mine is a recovering methamphetamine user, and a couple of years ago he was going through a really tough time and he decided that he wanted to finally get off it. He tried a couple of public residential rehabilitation services and they had gigantic waiting lists, like 3 months. He asked his parents if he could access a private rehab center, and they were willing to give him $30,000 to go to one for 3 months. That's huge. He was really lucky. He's got family members who had $30,000 who were willing to give it to him so he could go there for 3 months. He went, and now he's doing incredibly well, and I'm really proud of him. But I would argue that most people probably don't have access to that kind of funds. They might not have it themselves, they might not have family members or friends who will give it to them. And that's a huge barrier to accessing services when you don't have an adequate public service system. Confidentiality and anonymity concerns are also really big, particularly in, again, rural and regional locations. People might not want to access drug treatment or even generalist healthcare providers because they might be your neighbour or your childhood healthcare provider or your brother's ex-girlfriend or a childhood friend. And so you understandably might be worried about your information getting out to other people about some of your secrets and some of the activities you might be engaging in. Quickly, social ones, a fear of social rejection. If your time spent with your friends, your social group, is largely defined by the drugs that you're using, some people are very understandably concerned that if they decide to stop using those drugs, they won't be able to hang around with their social group anymore. Also, the belief that interacting with other treatment clients might facilitate drug use is a big one, particularly for people who are engaging in group treatment services like Alcoholics Anonymous, Narcotics Anonymous, that type of thing. They're worried that they might go there. They start talking about their drug use. They experience cravings. They meet someone who happens to have a gram of ice or heroin or pot in the back of the car. They relapse. Personal impediments. The perceived benefits of use might outweigh the harms. In consideration of the slides that I presented before, the benefits and the harms that my participants talked about, you can understand that some people would be really scared, for example, about discontinuing their drug use if they use it to treat their severe psychological issues. I'd be really scared about what my mental health was going to be after I stopped using whatever drug I was using. One that I want to talk a little bit more about is a lack of perceived need or motivation to access drug and alcohol treatment. And this is quite common among methamphetamine users. We've seen this in my own research in Australia, which I'll show you in a minute. But it's also been shown here in the United States and in a few other countries. So, sorry, there is a lot of information on this slide. Ignore the statistical jargon, but among my 255 regular methamphetamine users that I recruited in 2010, 41% didn't perceive their use to be problematic or harmful or severe enough to warrant professional support. And this can really be quite legitimate for a lot of people. I've got another couple of quotes there about that kind of represented the general opinion about why these people didn't want to access treatment. The one that really sticks out to me is the one from Rob, that's not his real name. I don't find I have a problem with methamphetamine. I'm not picking at imaginary things on my skin. I don't have festering sores. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. When we compared this group to the remainder of the sample, having low perceived need to access drug treatment was associated with being employed, less frequently regretting decisions made while methamphetamine intoxicated, having a reduced likelihood of getting injured or causing methamphetamine-related injuries, and a lower frequency of methamphetamine use in the previous month. So you can see that this group are probably a little bit more functional and engaging in less risky behaviours than their counterparts in the sample. However, there was some evidence of methamphetamine-related problems and risky use patterns among this group, which possibly indicated some unrecognized need amongst these participants. For example, we've got half of them who are classified as methamphetamine dependent. Like the other factors here, being methamphetamine dependent is associated with a higher likelihood of experiencing methamphetamine related harms. Using it quite frequently, I would argue that using it more than weekly is quite frequent. Injecting it and also experiencing significant financial methamphetamine related problems in the last 6 months. So these findings suggest that there is a need for initiatives that target this group to address concepts of what people would argue are problematic use or harmful use patterns, and to help identify harms and prevent the transition to more risky and harmful use patterns. And something that I blame for this, I don't really have anything to substantiate it, but is the programs like the Montana Meth Project. Are you guys familiar with that? I wish I'd included some pictures here. They're the before and after photos. So you've got someone who looks perfectly healthy, and then, you know, the picture says they used meth for 10 years, and they're missing their teeth, and they've got sores all over their face, and they're looking haggard. And that's sort of reflected in Rob's quote here, because you could be using methamphetamine at really harmful levels, but if you don't look like that stereotypical image, you might not identify as being a harmful meth user. And from my experience with working with hundreds of methamphetamine users, most of them don't look like that. So if you're making people think that's how you're supposed to look before you're actually classified as harmful, I think that's a problem. And I think that underlies this problem with low perceived need amongst this group for accessing professional support. So the moral of the story is that improving access to appropriate health, support and services for people who use drugs and preventing and reducing drug-related harms requires us to address the numerous barriers to treatment utilization as part of the solution. So it's about time that we talk about some substance use trends here in Maine. Most of the data over the next few slides was sourced from this report here. That's the cover of the report. I don't know who he is, and I did not take that photo. You can find this easily online if you just Google substance abuse trends in Maine. However, I'm not sure if I've mentioned that I've included my email address at the end of this presentation. So if you've got any questions, if you want the slides, if you have need any other information, feel free to email me or Sean, and I'll be more than happy to reply. I should note that the data presented here today vary regarding source and data collection, so the findings may not be entirely reflective of what's actually going on now. You'll notice that some of the data, the most recent that were available, were from 2013. The data types include some of the household survey findings from the National Survey on Drug Use and Health, treatment admissions, death data, drug arrest, and the results of forensic lab tests. Now, I just want to mention that using and comparing multiple data types is something that we call triangulation. It's really useful for generating a more comprehensive picture of what's actually going on with regard to drug use trends and drug-related harms in the community on a much larger scale. So here we're comparing the prevalence of various substances in Maine to the entire country over 2012 to 2013 and 2013 to 2014. If we look first at the licit substances, alcohol and tobacco, we see a higher prevalence of use in Maine compared to the entire United States. It's more obvious in relation to alcohol. And Maine also recorded higher rates of any illicit drug use compared to the entire country across both of those years. For those of you who can't read that writing down the bottom, this illicit drug category includes marijuana, cocaine, heroin, hallucinogens, inhalants, methamphetamine, and pharmaceuticals used non-medically. And it's interesting to see that, the discrepancy in use of illicit drugs in Maine compared to the United States is quite evident in the marijuana data there, and I'll be very interested to see what happens now that you guys have legalized it with respect to the data that's going to be collected over the coming years. And it's something that I'm interested to see with the other states as well that have legalized marijuana, like Colorado and Washington. And I don't know how, I'm going to be interested to see how we compare marijuana use in the coming years when it's legalized compared to when it was illegal. Next we have treatment admissions. So these are figures, the figures here for each substance are the percentage of all presentations for all drugs each year, if that makes any sense. So again, the most recent data we have for this are from 2013. So interestingly, we see an overall decrease of 11% in treatment admissions for alcohol, which, if I want to, talk about a tenuous link here, does correspond a little bit with that decrease in alcohol use disorders among the general population. However, we are seeing an increase in the percentage of presentations related to all opioids listed here, which you'll see is relatively consistent across the next few slides. I did not lump heroin and morphine together. I'm not really sure why they did this, but I kind of find it a little bit annoying. I want to tease out that trend a little bit more. And interestingly, we see a very consistently low percentage of people engaging with treatment and services with methamphetamine as their primary substance. I thought that might be a little bit higher. These figures are the percentages of all drug arrests by substance use and year. We can see there was an overall reduction in cocaine-related arrests by law enforcement agencies in Maine over 2009 to 2013, whereas the percentage of heroin arrests increased over that period. We also saw quite a notable reduction in methamphetamine-related arrests during that period. Here we have the figures the percentage of all drugs seized by law enforcement agencies each year. Again, we see an increase in the percentage of opioids seized, although there was a notable decrease in cocaine.
And this data, I should note, excludes benzodiazepines and tranquilizers, so drugs like Valium and Xanax.
Although their percentages didn't go above 4% that whole period. And for some reason, there was no methamphetamine data available in that report. So when I was researching drug trends in Maine, I stumbled across the following article. It wasn't hard, I just Googled drug trends in Maine, and this was one of the first ones that came up. And this is from just over a year ago. And in consideration of some of those opioid trends on the previous slides, the subheading attributes an increasing trend, an increasing trend in overdose deaths to heroin. And indeed, we seem to see that in this figure with the spike in illicit drug deaths, which is the green line, but it doesn't obviously clarify what they've defined illicit drug use to be. But the trend seems to have also been driven by deaths associated with the illicitly manufactured, i.e. non-pharmaceutical, fentanyl and fentanyl analogues. And as you can see, the number of deaths is increasing consistently across 2013 to 2016. So these data do highlight the issue of many fatal overdoses occurring in Maine due to a combination of drugs. Nearly two-thirds of the 2016 deaths reportedly involved illicitly manufactured opioid drugs, and 62% involved pharmaceutical drugs alone or in combination with other drugs or alcohol. I just want to remind you that this isn't a trend that's confined to Maine. It's happening across the entire country. So in consideration of this concerning trend, it's important that we develop and implement evidence-based measures to prevent and reduce the incidence of such drug-related harms. But how do we do this? I want to talk about a couple of approaches, the first one being harm reduction. When I talk about harm reduction, I'm referring to policies and programs and practices that aim to reduce the adverse consequences of both illicit and illicit drug use. The overall approach to harm reduction is basically acknowledging that people are going to engage in drug use, so we need to get them to do it as safely as possible. And if you want to use an analogy from a different field, it's like giving condoms to young people, because some of them are probably going to have sex and we want them to do it as safely as possible. So here's a couple of key harm reduction measures in Maine that are related to the opioid epidemic, if you want to call it that. The first is naloxone. And naloxone is a life-saving prescription medication used to essentially reverse opioid overdoses. Fortunately, in 2016, Maine lawmakers implemented a policy allowing pharmacists to dispense the drug to eligible individuals, including the friends and family of drug users. So if you've got someone in your life who you think might be at risk of an opioid overdose, you can now access naloxone through pharmacies and possibly save their life. You do have to go through a training program, and it does cost money though. Secondly, we've got needle syringe programs. Sorry, I'll call them syringe exchange programs. We call them something a little bit different in Australia. Very broadly, these distribute sterile injecting equipment to people who inject drugs, primarily to prevent the transmission of blood-borne viruses such as hepatitis C and HIV. And you can see that syringe exchange programs have been quite active in Maine over the last few years, with a huge increase in the number of enrollees in these programs of 225%, and a huge increase in the number of needles provided across 2010 to 2014. So I wanted to use syringe exchange programs as a terrific example of harm reduction, because they are such a holistic service, providing so many different types of services to address various types of drug-related harms and to prevent them as well. So for those of you, I don't know if you can read those. If you can't read that small writing up there, in addition to distributing sterile injecting equipment, they provide mechanisms for safe disposal of the same injecting equipment, so we've got less needles and syringes on the streets. They provide referral to mental health services, to substance use treatment. They provide HIV and hepatitis testing, and also Hep A and hepatitis B vaccination.
This wouldn't apply to all student exchange programs, but some of them definitely engage in all of these types of services.
Now to quickly discuss some harm reduction measures for other substance users, because I know everyone doesn't use opioids, and let's be honest, alcohol is one of the most harmful drugs out there. I just wanted to give you a couple of options for attempting to prevent and reduce harms related with people who might be out partying, so people who might be using alcohol, ecstasy, GHB, that type of thing. You might look at these and think that they're quite logical, but they're easy to forget after you've had a few drinks. And it's important to remember that we have these options available to us because they can save lives in some instances.
For example, providing blood alcohol concentration testing and alternative travel options could be very valuable in preventing drink driving.
And we all know what that can lead to. Also, I wanted to mention that bottom bullet point there, encouraging reduced substance consumption. There are a few really innovative methods out there, including drink tracking apps. A few of my colleagues back in Australia have tested out a few of these and evaluated them and have found that they can be quite effective, particularly among young people, in reducing really heavy drinking. You basically use the app and you log how many drinks you have at night, and it makes you a bit more conscious about how much you've been drinking. Another approach that a program that my friend implemented is My Mornings Matter, and that involves getting participants to make specific plans, particularly for weekend mornings, so that they're a bit more conscious the night before about reducing their substance use, so that they don't feel absolutely abysmal the next morning, and they actually make their plans happen. So that might be something as simple as making sure you read 2 chapters of a book, or go to brunch with some friends, or going on a bike ride, or something along those lines. And there's always Food Fast and Dry July, and I feel like every month now has some sort of alcohol abstinence approach associated with it. So
other methods of preventing and reducing drug-related harms. Look, I'm nearly done.
I apologise. How long have I gone for now? Is it about an hour? Okay, cool. Sweet. Okay, to finish off, drug treatment, which is one of the obvious ones. And again, this isn't available to everyone, particularly if you live in some areas where you don't have those brick-and-mortar services. You might be familiar with some of these service types: AA, Narcotics Anonymous, one-on-one drug counselling, detox, residential rehab. I think it's always important to acknowledge that there are non-traditional methods out there, like yoga and acupuncture and gym memberships, that I've seen really help people reduce their use or even stop using. My motto is, don't care if it doesn't work for other people, just do what works for you. None of these options is a silver bullet for treating drug use among every type of drug user. One person who wants to reduce their alcohol use or stop using alcohol might access Alcoholics Anonymous, but another person just might hate that 12-step model.
Doesn't matter, try something else, and whatever works for you, do that.
But I have seen that in Maine there is a helpline, is that correct? Yeah, I was in Utah a couple of months ago and they don't have anything along those lines, and even a phone helpline can be incredibly valuable for just speaking to someone and initiating that path to reducing and getting off drug use.
So, to wrap up, I'd like to acknowledge and thank the Fulbright Association for funding my time in the United States, everyone here at the University of Maine who's helped me with this visit, especially Paul and Sean, who've been really instrumental in
getting me here, and my team at UCLA and my team at the Burnett Institute in Melbourne. Thanks. Does anyone have any questions?
I'm from Wayne, Virginia.
Sorry?
I thought I had
one in the way of thinking,
but I was waiting for
that.
That's okay.
Could you speak up so that maybe the folks in Prescott can reach it?
The question I have is, like, in the beginning you said, like, you tested the people for, like, trials and stuff, but, like, over a period of time, how do they not get in trouble? Like, it's illegal?
Oh, so the question is, we involve methamphetamine users in trials and other types of research, and how do they not get in trouble because they're engaging in illegal behaviours? Well, generally, there's a few different answers to that. We usually have very good relationships with local law enforcement, and we usually advise them on the, when we're conducting a project like this, but that might be in relation to projects where we're actually recruiting people on the streets, so going to drug use hotspots and speaking to people and actually interviewing them in parks,
for example. But the trials, they have to come into our offices, and we are not legally obliged to divulge any of their information to any other third party unless they threaten to harm themselves or someone else. So just by telling us that you engage in illegal drug use is not reason enough for us to actually go, and we're not legally obligated to actually go to the police or to the courts or anything like that. But again, the caveat is if any activities they're engaging in or anything they say indicates that they have harmed or they are harming themselves or someone else, we usually have to go. Due to the drug use?
Yeah.
Oh, well, we'd probably have to do it then. Like, if they say, look, I'm going to get smashed and go and stab my neighbour, is that what you mean?
Yeah,
maybe
just
thinking it too far. Yeah, look, if they had intention to do that, yes, but if they... yeah, if there was any indication that regardless of whether they are intoxicated or not intoxicated, they actually had intention to go out and harm someone, we'd have to say something about that.
And for the folks that are listening in Prescott Hill, if you have any questions, please feel free.
I don't know how to do that.
Anyone else here?
Everyone's tired and wants to get home.
So other than the story with your grandmother, what other motivations did you have to get into your field, Brent?
It sounds far-fetched, but I, or a little bit, it sounds like I'm reaching a bit, but when I was 17, I went to the Philippines with a local charity and with a team of other young people, so I think I must have been about 17. And the whole idea was to go over there and experience a third world country. And we did that. There were about 10 of us who were aged 17 to 18. And it was just a profound experience where I realized that I wanted to help people who were, again, disadvantaged, marginalized, not so well off compared to myself and other people. And when I was at university, I sort of tested the waters with a few different volunteer agencies and found that I really liked the one that I mentioned, where I was working with young people who were experiencing mental health issues and alcohol and other drug problems. So I loved working with young people, and I loved I don't know why the drug and alcohol sector sort of called to me, but it's probably because I had seen a few friends experience significant problems associated with it, and I just thought that's an area that I'd like to get into. But yeah, that's the short answer, I guess.
How do you feel about your legalization of marijuana, and is it legal in Australia?
It's definitely not legal in Australia. And even our medical marijuana is legal, but you essentially have to be terminal to get it. So it's a lot stricter than some of the states here. I am definitely okay with medical marijuana. As far as I'm concerned, it's not anywhere near as harmful as many other substances, including alcohol, which is legal. There are harms associated with marijuana use, particularly mental health issues. But if you can tax it and you can use that extra money wisely and put that into drug treatment services and into education, I know that Washington State has funneled millions and millions of dollars into their education system. I think that you can kind of offset the harms associated with that. I've fallen through my education career, like I've fallen into my education career, whatever major or other area I did. So I started in criminology and psychology, and I did honours in criminology, and again, back then I actually found the drug topics most interesting, and my honours thesis was about chroming among young people in Melbourne. And through that, I did a presentation, and someone offered me a research assistant position at an organisation, and it was in their epidemiology department, and I didn't even know what epidemiology meant. And then a couple of years later, after being there and being a research assistant and just sort of doing my thing, my boss said, hey, how about you do a PhD? I've got some money for someone to do a PhD on methamphetamine. And that's how it happened. Not too complicated at all.
I was just wondering if you've done any research in regards to people who are dual diagnosis or have an underlying significant illness.
Any particular, with respect to anything in particular? It's something that we face a lot with our methamphetamine users, because they're a group of drug users who experience really high rates of mental health issues. So we do monitor rates or the mental health diagnoses that those participants have. I mean, I'm not a psychiatrist or a psychologist or a GP, so I can't officially diagnose them, but we do collect information from their records and from them themselves. So I guess, yeah, we monitor that really, really closely. But we do see high rates of like schizophrenia and depression and anxiety and bipolar disorder and borderline personality disorder. And with drug users, it's a really hard thing to determine in terms of the chicken or the egg, what came first. And as I've mentioned, a lot of people who use drugs tend to self-medicate, and that, while they might not realize at the time, tends to exacerbate that over the long term. So a lot of the time when you're treating drug and alcohol use, you have to be treating the mental health problems at the same time. And unfortunately, there's not a lot of services that are able to do that, whether they don't have the capacity or staff just don't have the experience or the knowledge. Sorry.
Yes, sir. Well, to go back to the previous question as it relates to how you feel about legalization of marijuana, as you touched on that there were side effects and that you were okay with the medication on it, but how do you feel about recreational usage?
I don't really mind about that. For me, it's again, it's not a particularly harmful drug. I mean, again, people can develop dependence on it, but I just firmly believe that while alcohol's legal, I don't really have a problem with marijuana being legal at all. And look, I'm not sure how I feel about legalization of every drug. It's something that I sort of fluctuate on. But to me, marijuana is just pretty unproblematic compared to most other substances that people use for recreational, for medicinal purposes. And the science is getting better about how we can administer it to people as well and reduce the types of harms that they experience. So, yeah, and look, and working with police officers and law enforcement agencies, it's just a drug that they don't really have much concern for as well. I mean, they arrest people because they're supposed to, but they know that it's generally not going to lead to fights on the street and people engaging in really complicated criminal activities and violence and that type of thing. So it's also not really on their radar, apart from the fact that it's classified as illegal. So, yeah, I do really like that there are states in the United States that are making that change. Sorry,
yeah. Yeah, I'm going to show my ignorance.
That's okay.
But aside from crystal meth, I'm assuming what other drugs are part of the methamphetamine?
Well, it really just comes down to, I mean, I'm not a chemist by any means, but it comes down to the way that it's cooked and the form that it comes out in. So in Australia, traditionally, we had speed powder, and that was amphetamine, but law enforcement agencies haven't actually seized any amphetamine in Australia since the late 1990s. So all the speed that we're seeing now is methamphetamine, just in a different form to the crystal form, and it's usually a lower purity traditionally, but sometimes it actually can get up to that 70-80% like crystal meth as well.
So methamphetamine is like the new
amphetamine? In Australia it is. In America you still get the amphetamine side of things. I know when I say methamphetamine I have to be very clear, because it generally only refers to the crystal form of it.
Okay.
But yeah, the speed is generally the amphetamine side of things.
Does Australia incorporate Suboxone?
We do, yes. So we've had Suboxone for a while. So for those who don't know, Suboxone is one of those pharmaceutical approaches to treating opioid dependence and withdrawal, that type of thing. So the other forms are methadone and buprenorphine. So Suboxone is the new one that came in maybe 7 or 8 or 9 years ago, and it came in because people were injecting the other forms. So it came in because it was supposedly a non-injectable form of the opioid that people could use, but it turns out people who use drugs are very creative. They're like, same with prisoners. They, if they want to do something, they'll find a way. I'm always really impressed with how creative they can be. But yeah, we do have Suboxone.
Do you know of any programs or types of programs that have been successful in rural areas specifically?
That's a really tricky area. I mean, look, as I said, drug treatment can be successful for people. For example, just basic one-on-one counseling, cognitive behavioral therapy can be really successful with a number of people. And a number of different drug users, you know, methamphetamine, heroin, cannabis, etc. So if you've got a service that is able to address all those barriers that I talked about, like confidentiality and anonymity and opening hours and that type of thing, that can be perfectly fine. Some of the projects that I'm involved in Australia, particularly in relation to Indigenous users, we're experimenting with a few online modules and also some telephone helplines as well, and we're getting really promising results out of those. I mean, obviously people who are in really rural areas that don't have any services or that type of thing, I mean, fortunately in Australia the internet is quite good in rural areas, so we can get them online and speaking to councils, and they're usually 24/7 services as well. So I'm a great advocate of that. I think if there's money available, it's a really cheap service and it can access people who otherwise wouldn't be able to attend a service in person.
Has that been initiated for a long enough period to determine the efficacy
of like a telehealth or telecounseling service? Yes, I got a report that I can send you. I mean, I've got your email address. I've got a report that I can send you. My old organisation from 10 years ago started one. An online service for Australia, and it was originally just my state of Victoria, but it's expanded nationwide. So I'll get that report and I'll send it to you. If I forget to, just make sure you send me an email. It does show that there is definitely efficacy there with regard to both mental health and sort of substance use outcomes.
Sorry.
No worries.
In your experience, people who have sort of problems with
I think there has been a lot of research conducted on that, and you definitely will find a lot of people who have substance use issues who have some sort of previous trauma or psychological issue in their life. I mean, that is disproportionately represented among people who use those substances, but it can happen to sort of anyone. I mean, if you're going through a rough period and you start drinking alcohol, one day you might wake up and find out that without any previous mental health issues or trauma, you've developed alcohol dependence. But again, you do see disproportionately higher rates of trauma and psychological issues among people who have substance use dependence.
And so there's not a genetic component, but I know you say about alcohol, that if you have someone in your family who's alcoholic, you have a higher chance of becoming alcoholic yourself.
There is research that demonstrates that, but it's kind of conflicting. I know with the crack babies in the United States, there was some research that came out that was sort of the definitive research that showed that you're significantly more likely to engage in crack use, but then there's other research that's since come out that shows that that's definitely not the case, as long as you have like a decent upbringing after that. So the research, there is conflicting research, but there definitely is research that shows that
if you have a decent upbringing, decent education, decent diet, that type of thing, and various other factors that that influence functionality and lead to a stable life, you can lead a perfectly healthy life without substance use dependence.
Is injection the most common way to use
methamphetamine? Is depending on the form, but the crystal side of things is usually smoked.
So I don't know if you've seen, when I was in New York, I saw a lot of tables and desks just on the side of the road with people with glass smoking implements. But in Australia, in my state, we've actually banned the sale of glass pipes, which I have a little bit of a problem with. But yeah, the crystal methamphetamine is usually smoked. And then I would say, if you are a person who injects drugs, you're probably more likely to do that. But if you don't do that, you're more likely to crush it up and snort it or administer it orally after that.
It's different with speed powder. Speed powder is commonly injected in Australia.
Yep, in Australia it is.
So is one more effective,
I'm
assuming the snorting is more
effective? No, generally the rule is injecting is the most effective, and then smoking, and then snorting, and then oral administration.
Okay, yes, so there is, they're not all, they don't all.
Oh, no, definitely not. So injecting is generally spontaneous, instantaneous, and smoking is not far behind that.
But they're associated with different types of harms. Smoking and injecting are a lot more harmful than administering it orally or snorting it.
So.
So as a follow-up, would you say the SSP is 89 under 100?
Sorry, what was that?
Okay, so you mentioned that we know that injecting and syringe usage, because of the height of this individual, it's more common. So what we say that SSB is 80 the upright minimum fit. It's giving condoms to 20-year-olds, you're not supposed to do it, but if you do, why not protect yourself?
No, so you were asking if by distributing the clean needles that are increases rates of injecting drug use, is that right?
Well, I read that on this guide it says it doesn't increase it.
Oh, so there's the number of people who are enrolled are increasing, but the number of people and the number of syringes that are getting distributed are increasing as well. But that doesn't mean that injecting drug use is going up. It probably means that injecting population is increasingly accessing that type of service. In Australia, we implemented syringe exchange programs on a very wide scale back in the 1980s, and so we've been able to conduct a lot of research into how that might have affected rates of injecting drug use in the community, and we have no evidence that's increased the prevalence of injecting drug use.
So, which form of drug would you say is mostly injected, legal or illegal?
Which is more what, sorry?
Which form, illegal drugs or legal drugs, are you seeing the most used for?
Mainly the illegal side of things. I mean, yeah, you can inject some of the legal ones, like the pharmaceutical opioids. I mean,
that's classified as misusing it. But that can be incredibly harmful for your veins, and I would never advise anyone to do anything like that. But it's more the heroin.
Alright, so back to my previous question,
Is it aiding and abetting, injecting the illegal drugs?
Well, you can never control what people are going to be doing with that,
you can, I guess, but yeah, you're not going to walk back to people's homes or an alley or anything like that. So the best you can do with is provide education at those types of services about how they can avoid various harms. And the best way to do it is to not try and inject those pills. But there is other equipment available that can minimize the harms associated with injecting pills as well. But it's incredibly damaging to you. If you're injecting a pill, you've got talc in it, so it can get lodged in your extremities, and you can get gangrene, so your fingers get chopped off. It can get in your eyes and infect your eyes, and you can go blind. It's really not good for you.
Two more questions, if there are two more.
Thank you.
Well, Brendan, thank you so much for coming all the way here from UCLA and coming to the States from Melbourne. Great to have you. Thank you again for all that you've shared with us today.
And thanks, everyone. So we'll send me an email. I'm on it all the time, and I'll happily get back to you if you have any questions or if you need slides or anything like that.